questions. Do you want anybody to be on? No, there we go. Let's start over on this side.
She's wondering if Squirrel Girl is going to be in the new Infinity War.
That's the tail. Oh, I see it now. You were hiding your tail. I don't know. But I really know nothing about the movie. We've been shooting for about 6 months, and I can tell you that I fly and I beat people up. That's pretty much the plan. But I would love for you to be on the road, girl.
That's like shooting the flying stuff, by the way, because I feel like, you know, a lot of it's like they put in later in the CG, but does it feel like ridiculous on set if you're just kind of like, you know, guys like with wires and you're just like trying to look badass while you're doing it?
Yeah, you never, the worst thing in the world is being a superhero that flies. It's because they literally just sit on the train and let you go. And as soon as we don't have an actual flying mechanism, so it's very uncomfortable. And you're on a 4-foot harness and you're just hanging there all day. So if you're not, like this movie, I got in shape for it. The other movies, I wasn't in shape for it. And it was the most painful thing in the world. Yeah, and every now and then they'll just leave me up there and go to lunch. I'm like, oh, this is so funny, somebody's getting punched in
the face. It's like an Avengers pinata or something like that.
Yeah, it's we do a lot of jokes on each other. That was my joke day, getting messed up in my harness. And everybody was at lunch. And it was cookie and ice cream day, which really made me mad. I was like, come on, it's cookie and ice cream day.
So, if you had the opportunity to do another lip sync battle with LL Cool J, what song would you do?
Did LL pay you to mention his name? Because he would do that. That's the type of dude LL is. You know, it's funny. I thought I picked some pretty good songs, and I was very upset that Joseph beat me just by touching his leg and his chest. I was like, that's not dancing. When was the last time you went out and saw a dude like, yo, baby, you want to dance? It's not dancing, homie. I came out the floor. So, if y'all don't know, Lip Sync Battle is a TV show where you lip sync and dress up like the person you're lip syncing as. And I did Katy Perry, murdered it. Because I love Katy Perry. If any of y'all know her, tell her, I say, what up, dude? And I did MC Hammer, which I murdered because I can do the Chinese typewriter, which nobody ever can, like I can. Because I stay on my toes, I don't go flat footed, and I have this thing when I end, kill it. But I would probably do Baby Got Back. You know that song? Sir Mix-a-Lot, might be before your time. Is that your theme song? Oh, okay, I'm just saying, just put it on, dog. We can rock out.
Totally downloading it.
He is. Right now, he's like, hot tuning it up.
Oh, let's jump back over this side.
What up, other black guy?
Hey.
What's up, baby? Thank you for coming out, homie. We'll hook up later.
Do you think your character will become Captain America, like in the comics?
I don't know. You know, I'll be honest, I love working with Chris. He's one of my dearest friends. And I enjoy the idea of Cap and Falcon being together. I'll just leave it at that. But for real, I'm kidding. Tweet that. Tell him I'm stupid. That's got to be sorry.
How did you get the part of Harry
in the film The Adjustment Bureau, and what was it like working on that movie?
Oh, this guy. I like this guy. The movie was very hard to work on, because Matt Damon and Emily Blunt are the most ridiculous people you've ever met in your life. And all we did on set was make fun of each other and laugh and joke. And it took us like a month longer than it should have, because we just made fun of each other. And we did. But I got the part, I met with George Nolfi, who directed it, and we just hit it off. To this day, we literally talk to each other once every 2 days. He's one of my close friends now. And it was a lot of fun. We got to shoot in New York. And we literally went to, that movie's a love letter to New York. We went to every major monument in New York. We shot in Yankee Stadium. We shot at the Statue of Liberty. Like, it was a great experience. I got to go to my favorite Rose Capullo place. Wow, shoot. I don't know if you care about the Rose Capullo part, I just put that in. You have to go to New York, go to 165th, and Arnold, get you some Rose Capullo. And pretty good ones, too.
Really easy to delay what's said on stage and like people hearing it. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, there's like, they're like,
that's the crazy. It's
really everyone.
Hello!
Hey, Matt.
Hi. You have a great haircut.
Thank you.
Fashionista.
My question for you is, what does it mean for you and your character to be an Avenger?
It's huge. I think for Sam Wilson, it's, you know, all of this is still new to you. You know, if you look at the progression of my character in the Marvel Universe, it's funny because he finds out Captain America's real and he goes to being his, you know, his cohort, his fighting partner. So now it's he has input and say, so he's slowly evolved into the Avenger world. So it's all doing the content. This is, you know, from the same way.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hey,
Matt. But she does look that good in the costume. Like, there's no, all the dudes have padding. She has no padding. I'm like, that's amazing. Where's your man? There's no man. Like, Paul Bettany has a fake butt. I just put that out there. Just because it's Paul Bettany, he has a fake butt. All right, there you go. There's your Avenger fact of the day. Paul Bettany, his butt is so small, he has a fake butt. There you go. Tweet that.
No matter what else he said today, that's going to be the
ball. That's it. I have to give you one thing. That's it. I'll leave on. What's up, guy?
Hey, Andy. What was your funniest blooper on and off set?
My funniest blooper on set was probably, I had to land one day. It's the scene where I'm coming in Civil War, and Rhodey gets shot down and Iron Man shoots me. And I'm coming in hot and heavy. And the next take, they pull me up higher. And I'm like, no, dog, everything is too high. And I'm like, no, you're fine. Like, you can do it. And they let me go. And literally, I couldn't get my feet under me. So I just hit the ground and, like, skidded for, like, 10 feet. And we had to shut down for lunch because I was covered in dirt. And it was awful. But another moment, they stood there in my life. And that was actually Mexican Day, and I miss Mexican food, which I love. It's really annoying. It's a true story. I had a Mexican truck, and the dude was making Mexican, like tacos and shit. Like the Mexican corn? I missed it.
I love how your shoot days are sorted by the menu.
Pretty much. That's how I roll. I can't work with bad food. Who's up, Bob?
With Lauren Prosper.
Oh. Oh, I thought you started talking Dutch or something. I was like, damn, Spock is gangster.
I was recently.
Oh. Damn, Spock is gangster.
Detroit, and a consistent theme was your performance and how strong it was and how good you were in the movie. And I was just wanting to hear you talk about that story and what it was like to film that movie and how it was a story that took, what, time-wise, was a ways away but doesn't feel like it's that far away in our culture. Like, the same shit just kind of keeps happening. So yeah, I just wanted to hear you about your experience and what it was like to take on that role.
Great question. Detroit is a very important story because in 1964, there was racial tension in America was really high, just like now. And there was this small hotel called the Algiers Hotel right outside Detroit. The police said that someone was shooting at them, so the police, the National Guard, and the military surrounded this hotel, rushed in, and kept 8 people hostage for 3 hours and killed 4 of them and never found a weapon or anything to prove that these people were shooting at them. And then a year later, those same cops that punished and killed these young men in this hotel were set free by Julia DeVries, which sounds like today. And it, for me, I don't really do movies because of the size of the role. I've been popular for a long time, so my ego is in check. It's more about, no, certain people like sit around and tell their agents they won't do a movie unless they're the lead of the movie. It's crazy. So stories like Detroit are really important because we don't know where we're going unless we know where we came from. And so many people are surprised when things like police shootings happen. And I'm like, that's not new. My dad always said, if you do the same thing over and over, you're going to get the same results. So at some point in time, we have to realize what we're doing wrong and correct it to break the pattern. So I try to do movies like Detroit to break that pattern. I have a movie that I'm doing now called The Hate U Give. And I have like 2 scenes in the movie, but I'm doing it because it's very important for little girls to realize that they have a voice, to realize that they're strong human beings and individuals, and they can do and be whatever they want to do and be. When I read this book and I saw they were doing a movie and I read the script, I was blown away by the idea that this little girl, when facing all the odds in the world, could stand up and say, no, this is who I am and this is who I'm going to be. I think that's very important, you know. So Detroit kind of all along the lines of that. And it was a great experience. I love doing historical, factual movies because when you're doing the research, you learn so much. You know, you talk to people from that period, from that town, from that generation, and you learn a lot. Like, I was really dumb before I started acting. And then once I started acting and being able to do research in the correct way and learn how to research projects, it really informed my opinions when it came to worldly issues. Thank you, Spock. Gangsta Spock.
And also, to be Star Wars fans, John Boyega also.
So. Oh, I was like, I'm not John Boyega.
No. I mean, hey, it's like Star Wars and Marvel colliding.
Yeah. I have John Boyega socks.
Oh, okay.
They made little black dude inspired Star Wars socks. I bought them.
Okay.
Come on, lady. a question asked by someone who's never been in a fight. Am I correct?
Exactly.
So I'll ask you a question to answer your question. If you get in a fight with someone, you hit them more than they hit you, and then they run away, who won that fight? So next time, if you ever get in a fight, go into that fight knowing that you have to hit that person more than they hit you. And then they'll run away. Think about it. Hello, little lady.
I was wondering, what Avenger character can you relate to the most and why?
I would say I can relate to the Hulk. Because there's a person inside this polo that really likes getting in fights.
But you have to control that and be the guy at the poker. There you go. Well, yep, I tried.
Didn't work.
No. I tried on his birthday, actually. Didn't work.
Given the chance of the reason increasing problems with Tom Holland, would you prefer to prank Sebastian again or team up with him and get his
money? Very good question. I don't like to be around time for more than 5 minutes, so I just like making fun of Tom. Just because he's such a great guy. And he's Billy Elliot. I love that play. I would like to team up with Sebastian and get Tom. Just because his movie was so successful.
Did you know Sebastian going into the film? Because I feel like you guys, I saw you in the D23 carpet, and you two were like, the bromance was so strong. So strong.
No, the great thing is Sebastian and I couldn't be more opposite, so we work perfectly well together. But no, I met him on Captain America, on Winter Soldier, and we just clicked. Like, Chris and I, we just clicked, and for some weird reason, it was the perfect storm. Yeah, we've been boys ever since.
Yeah, you can tell. On the screen,
yeah,
like, you guys kind of sentences.
It would be an awful movie if I didn't like them. Because I've been on those movies where you really hurt the hate person. I mean, despise that person. And that's normal.
Oh, what is that?
Look at that. I got that. Nobody else got that. Nobody else caught that. I know. Now, after this, everybody's going to be coming up to you. Hey, Oiler Woman, watch.
Followers.
No, I wasn't. I wasn't a comic book fan at all. I was more of a sports, baseball card kind of guy. Edmonton Oiler fan. True story. Ever since I was a kid, I was an Edmonton Oiler fan. And if they had made it this year, I was going to come for the games. I was a huge Edmonton Oiler fan. I even have a jersey, like, when they show the games, and I'm around, like, a sports car. I put my number and my name on the jersey. I'm not wearing no other dude. I can't remember the other dude's name on my jersey. That's weird. Now I might get a jersey that say, Oiler Woman. I do that, but you know, maybe like Greg Steele. Come on. But that's it.
Thank you.
Hello.
Hi, Anthony. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
So the Falcon is a fantastic character, but if you have the chance to be any other Marvel hero, who would you be and why?
I would either be Nick Fury. Just because Sam Jackson has made him such a badass, like, I just want to be Shaft and Fury. Sam has made him into, like, he turns into a cape. I'm like a Shaft. Or I would be the Hulk. I just like the Hulk. Like, Mark Ruffalo is amazing.
Is Loki in the
new
Avengers movie?
I don't know. I don't like Loki. I don't know. I haven't seen him because it was horns. Yeah, you got the horns for the horns. You ever think about that superhero costumes? They sit around. Because, like, superheroes have to make their own costumes, right? So when Loki was making his costume, he was like, you know what I'm missing? Horns. I think that'd be real badass. And he made horns. I think that's weird. No, my opinion. I thought you were going to make a dirty joke. Oh, come on. The people want it. Okay, all right. Daughter, close your ears. Come on.
Thank you.
You ever look at, I'm like, everybody else have their hands in their pockets, they're like, no, they're pulling out little stuff and they're doing that. You never see me pull nothing out. Like, cause, and I'm a snack dude, you know? Like, it's very annoying. No pockets. You wouldn't believe where I have to put myself. Think about it. What's up, Cool Breeze? My man wears sunglasses inside. Hell yeah.
Costume.
I like it.
In Detroit, I just figured I'd say. I was just wondering, because the Punisher trailer just dropped and Charlie Cox is here, if there was any Marvel TV hero you could meet, which one do you want to meet? Because John Bernthal's pretty hot.
Good question. I don't know. You stumped me. That's the stump. I would like to be myself on TV. That would be good. Or Nick Fury. I would be like a young, I would be Nicholas Fury. I just want the turn when my cape goes, that's all I want. Every episode. That was all I got. Sorry for the guy.
Thank you for that. Good
great fear. Jeez.
Thank you. We have the same birthday.
Oh, shy.
Never mind.
And
what was the best birthday surprise
you
ever got?
About 6 years ago, a friend of mine, one of my best friends, JC Juan Carlos, this is his real name, got me one of my favorite cigars and took me to see U2 in New York. And if you haven't seen U2 live, take it from a brother. Bono, man. Like, it is. The Streets Have No Name is one of the best songs ever written. So, that was one of my best birthday surprises. All right, your hair is amazing. Like, I don't know what that is.
I remember the first time I met you at a hotel or something, and then Civil War had just come up, and I asked you, like, congrats, man, you must be celebrating. And you were like, no, it's not really my movie. Like, but you're on the poster and it's breaking records, and then you're like, yeah, I'm gonna have a cigar.
It was. I was like, man. Nah, they were like, the movie did well. Hey, it's not like Falcon. That's a whole different conversation.
That was a French title.
I might wear a tuxedo. Hello, beautiful young lady.
Happy birthday, by the way.
No, we fight about other stuff, but we don't fight about Captain America. We mostly fight about snacks. We are like 5-year-olds when it comes to snack time. So if they run out of almonds on set, like, you know, there's always a push-up contest for the last bag of almonds. Or if I get a protein shake and he don't, it's a problem. Huge. Or if he gets one, I'm shutting down practice. Pretty much how we roll. You're welcome.
Hi, I was just wondering, like, what was your favorite prank that you pull on someone or that someone has pulled on you on set?
Very cool. This movie I just did, this is bad, I shouldn't have did this, but a friend of mine was a prop guy. He had his new assistant. And the guy was just very overzealous with his job. Like, every time they said cut, he'd like run up and take my earpiece and my gun. I'm like, yo, I don't like people to touch me. I'm like, I ain't touching you, don't touch me. You know, I say touch me, can you touch me? But don't touch me, right? So I get annoyed by this guy, so and he's new. So I get one of the PAs to tell him that he has to get all of my place settings and my scene and move them to another set. Right? So we're ready to roll, set the camera. And I'm like, yo, where's all my stuff? Where's my stuff? I don't have my stuff. Props are supposed to put my stuff here. Who's responsible for my stuff? And you see one person run out of the room. And he comes back in like 3 minutes late, fumbling stuff. There's guns everywhere, bullets all over the place, pencils. And
I had the Russo brothers go up to him and be like, you know, we're going to have to talk to you at the end of the day about this. And this dude lost it. I mean, crying, and I felt so bad. I'm like, all right, I'm sorry. But it was, he's scarred for life, but he knows not to mess with it. No, don't touch it. He knows that. I know it sounds awful now that I tell the story.
Thank you so much.
It was funny, though. People laughed. Dorito, there's a connotation here. Why would we call him Dorito?
Because he's shaped like a Dorito.
That's funny.
I spent too much time on the internet.
Someone's getting a text as soon as we get on. No. I've never called him Dorito. No, I've never. That's great. No. So much. See, this is where panels get you in trouble. There's so much I can say about that with Chris, but I won't. What flavor of Dorito would you be?
Probably Cool Ranch.
No. I'm Cool Ranch. Let's say Zesty Salsa. How about that? The answer is no, but I will. You're the best. He's like, ask your question.
Big fan, congrats on Detroit. I grew up across the river in Windsor, Ontario.
Windsor, that's my jam.
And I just wanted, if you could talk about working with Eminem in 8 Mile. And I always wanted to say, what up, Papa Doc? I read that the battles in 8 Mile were legit and not pre-written.
No.
And so if you could just talk about that.
Watch the mic.
Yo, he's bananas.
It's like he's in 8 Mile. Eminem was dope. Eminem, one of those people who showed up professional, ready to work every day. And a lot of that story evolved and became what it became because of Eminem. All the battles were 100% improv on set. We had one of the best battle rappers of all time on set working with us, Rick G. And you know, it's funny, like, our last scene between Eminem and I, Eminem picked that song, Shook Ones, by Mobb Deep. And when they played the beat, Curtis Hanson was like, well, shouldn't we play some of the songs so people know what it is? And M looked at him and was like, man, if people don't know what this is, they shouldn't be watching the movie anyway. We were like, hell yeah. And that kind of set the tone for the rest of the movie, that one statement. So if you don't know Shook Ones, get that. Scared to death, scared to look, you shook. There ain't no such thing as halfway crooks. No one was able to complete that verse. No one was able to complete that shit. That's my view. The influence. All right, see what happens. See how it happens.
Well, we have number one more, and I think it's very serendipitous that it's Tom Holland.
What's up,
Spider-Man?
It's a tight suit.
First of all, I get the no pockets thing. It's terrible.
I know. It makes you just want to grab your crotch, right?
Yeah.
Look, I tell you, that's what it is. So, it's your only pocket.
What?
It's your only pocket.
Exactly.
You have to hold something.
You mentioned you like.
Be proud of that, man. Be proud of that. Yeah, there we go. Now let me do this later, man.
You mentioned you like doing historical movies. If there was one historical event that you could do a movie on, what would it be?
Great question. I don't know. My dream, which would never happen, is to play Napoleon. Like, if you don't know, Napoleon was a bad dude, man. The whole idea of the Napoleon complex is all misconstrued, right? So Napoleon was arrested by the French
and sent away to an island in the middle of the Mediterranean. So they would go check on him to make sure he never left the island. So they sent a boat to check on Napoleon. Napoleon was so gangster, he made the entire crew get him off the island, make him the captain of the boat. He sailed back into Italy and took it over with one boat. Come on, man. That's all gangster. So from here on out, when you think of the Napoleon complex, that just means you gangster. No problem, man. Grab that pocket, grab that pocket.
We covered a lot. Fake bloods, Napoleon, trips to Jamaica, Doritos. Wow.
The Dorito.
What an amazing panel. This is good. So follow us out.
I'm doing it. I'm doing it. I gotta do it.
You. Someone in Canada said you are a zesty Dorito. Much love, Anthony. Would you like to sing? Send. Our Chris is a zesty Dorito.
Do you have, do you look at Avengers group chat on your phone, by the way? Does that exist?